Good afternoon, all of you. My name is Thakur Rajaram. I am working as an assistant professor in St. Martin's Engineering College. Today, in this session, we will discuss about the dielectric phenomena and dielectric properties of materials. So, firstly, what is dielectrics? So, we see that depending on the materials, we are having conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. So, in this chapter, we will discuss about the dielectrics. So, firstly, what are conductors? So, conductors are nothing but the materials which conducts the electricity. So, there is no band gap between the conduction band and valence band and conduction band. There is no conduction band here it is. So, these two bands will overlap with each other. So, there is no energy gap in between here. So, that we are having conducting electrons in the conduction band here. In case of insulators, what happens is there are no free electrons in these particular materials. So we can say that the energy band gap between the valence band and conduction band is very much higher in this insulator case. This is nearly equals to 7 electron volts. So it is very high band gap. So that we cannot say that there is a possibility of the electrons to move from this conduction valence band to conduction band for conducting the electricity. So in these materials, the electrons are very tightly bonded. And in case of semiconductors, we will have less band gap between the valence band and conduction band. So it is nearly 1 electron volt. So if we apply minimum energy, that is 1 electron volt energy, so that the valence electrons can move into the conduction band and electricity can be electrons may conduct the electricity here. So nextly, we are dealing with the dielectrics now. So dielectrics are nothing but the insulating materials. So these materials are nothing but, we can say the example for the dielectrics as glass. Second example for this, mica. So like that we can have some more examples of dielectric materials. So in these materials the atoms are very tightly bound to each other, so that we cannot say that it allows electrons to freely to move to the conduction band and for conducting the electricity. Now we will see the dielectric constant. So what is dielectric constant? So this can be indicated by K. So we can define dielectric constant K, that is equals to the permittivity of the medium towards the permittivity of free space. So the ratio between permittivity of the medium to the permittivity of free space we can write as the dielectric constant. And we can also find out, depending on the capacitance, if we take parallel plate capacitor, so in the medium it will be C equals to A epsilon by D. For a free space, parallel plate capacitance will be A epsilon naught by D. So let us write C naught here. So the ratio of C by C naught simply gives us epsilon by epsilon naught, which is equals to K. So this K is nothing but the dielectric constant. Now we can find out the, if we are having for example, let us discuss about the atomic view of polarization. So atomic view of polarization. So as we have told that the dielectric materials are the materials in which the atoms are closely packed, so that there is in the nucleus, so the electrons are very tightly bound with the nucleus, so that these electrons cannot be used for the electrical conductivity purpose. So here it is a proton and neutron will be there in the nucleus. So these probability density of the electrons is very nearer to the nucleus, so that the electrons cannot be conducted. So that we can say that there is no separation or no distance between these two positive charges and negative charges. That means these are nothing but the non-polar molecules or non-polar atoms. So the center of gravity of these protons and neutrons are coinciding in case of nonpolar molecules. That's why there is no separation. That means there is no dipole moment. That is, dipole moment we can define as the induced dipole moment, induced charges into the length, that is the separation between the positive and negative charges. So we can write the dipole moment, that is, let us consider for our consideration the distance between positive and negative charges is 2a, and qa is the induced charge. So we can write the dipole moment, that is, p equals to 2a qi in this case. Now, so we are saying that there is no separation between these two positive and negative charges in case of dielectrics. If we want to know that if there is if we want to make separation between these two molecule these two positive and electric positive and negative charges, then we need to apply electric field so that this electric field will make the positive induced charge and negative induced charge in the dielectric material. So let us consider the example of CO2. In this CO2 molecule, we will be having 1C atom and 2 oxygen atoms. So these two atoms are moving nearer to the carbon atom, so that this is a nonpolar molecule. That means there is no separation. That means if there is no separation in between the positive charges and negative charges, that means this is a nonpolar molecule case, and we can say that there is no dipole moment existing in this particular molecule. So no dipole moment exists in this molecule. So that means even if you apply if we do not apply any electric field, that means there is no separation between the positive charges and negative charges in this particular molecule, so that there is no dipole moment. That means the dipole moment p equals to 0 in this case. We can take the dipole moment as 0 in this case because there is no distance separation and there is no charge in this, so that we can write for non-polar molecules that there is a 0 dipole moment. Now if we consider the polar molecules, in case of polar molecules, we will have the permanent dipole moment for the electron and proton in an atom. So in that atom, we can say that there is a possibility of separation between the positive and negative charges. That means simply we can say that there is a separation even if in the absence of electric field, these atoms carry or these molecules carry some dipole moment in them. So let us take an example for polar molecule, that is H2O. So in H2O molecule, we can say that we are having one H atom and two oxygen atoms which are moving away from this hydrogen atom. So there is a separation between the positive and negative charges, so that we can say that there exists a dipole moment, that is permanent dipole moment in this particular molecule. Permanent dipole moment exists in this molecule. So we can say that this is a polar molecule. And nextly, if we apply the electric field for this hydrogen molecule, so we can simply say that the dipole moment, that is resultant dipole moment, will become induced dipole moment plus the permanent dipole moment pp. So we can say that if we apply the electric field to the H2O molecule, then there is a p induced, that is dipole moment induced, and the permanent dipole moment that is already existed in that polar molecule. So this is about the polar molecules and non-polar molecules. Now we will discuss about the susceptibility, that is the electric susceptibility. Electric susceptibility can be defined as the electric polarization divided by the electric field intensity. We can say that the susceptibility is equals to dipole electric polarization divided by the electric field intensity of electric field. Now we need to define the polarization. So what is polarization? Simply is the induced dipole moment divided by the volume of the dielectric, so that we can write qi into L divided by the volume, can be written as area into distance So simply we can write Qi by A, so that is equals to surface charge density sigma I. So in this case we find out the electric polarization of that is polarization we can write as induced surface charge density. Now we will move on to the discussion about the susceptibility, the relation between D, E and P. So here we are having the displacement current and the electric field intensity and the polarization. So the difference between these two or the relation between these three things we can find out. So what is first the displacement current is. So displacement current can be defined as the charge surrounded by some area. So the ratio of charge surrounded by some area gives us the displacement current. So simply electric field can be defined as the force acting per unit charge. Otherwise we can also define it by the flux divided by surface area. So you can write the electric field intensity like force per unit charge or the electrical flux divided by some unit surface area. Now what is P? We already know that P equals to Q induced divided by the area. So these three between these three, what is the relation? Let us find out. First of all, let us start our discussion with Gauss's law. So what Gauss's law in dielectrics? Let us consider plus Q charge and minus Q charge. These are two parallel plate capacitors and which are separated by some region. Let us draw the region as P, Q, R, S, and for this also capacitor, parallel plate capacitor, P, Q, R and S. In between, let us say that the region in between is air medium. So the electric field direction will be from this positive charge to negative charge, that is let us consider E0. Next thing, for Gauss law in dielectrics and the Gauss law in case of air medium, firstly let us write the Gauss law for air medium, that is integral E dot E naught dot ds equals to Q by epsilon 0. So we can write the permittivity of free space here because we are using air medium. Next thing, we can write E naught, the surface area is A, so that will be equals to Q by epsilon 0. Now in next case we can write E0 equals to Q by A epsilon 0. So this is electric field, that is we can say in terms of Gauss law for air medium. Now if we remove the air medium from the parallel plate capacitors and introduce the dielectric slab in between these two parallel plate capacitors, so that the electric field direction is positive to negative, and in between we are keeping a dielectric medium or dielectric slab. So the charge which is induced by this dielectric slab will be plus Q I here, that is induced charge because of the electric field, and minus Q I charge will be here and plus Q charge will be here. So that we can draw a Gaussian surface for this as P dash, Q dash, R dash and S dash. And next here also we can draw a Gaussian surface. P dash, Q dash, R dash and S dash. Now what is the Gauss law for dielectric slab? So let us consider we are having now the resultant charge what it will become and resultant electric field what it will be. So E equals to E0 minus EI. So resultant electric field will be the E0, that is opposite to the direction of applied electric field. E0 let us take the external field and EI is opposite to that particular field. Now the charge, resultant charge will also become Q dash equals to Q minus QI. Now as we know that E equals to E0 minus EI, so we can write here, let us write Q dash by, so for Gauss law in dielectrics, integral of E dot ds equals to Let us take result term charge, that is q dash by epsilon naught, which is equals to q minus qi by epsilon 0. Now let us derive the Gauss law in case of dielectrics. Okay, so we will derive the remaining Gauss law in dielectrics in the next session. So thank you for your attention.